This is a signal, which I'm going to put into a system to show you the genius technique to find the output to any signal. But that's not all. I'm going to show you how we use operators and some weird functions to help us. It starts with these circuits, which, as you might remember from circuit analysis, give you an equation by applying Kirchhoff's voltage law. That is, going over each element in a loop, adding the voltages, then making them all collectively sum to zero. But this is not just any equation. This is a linear time-invariant equation. And I'm not going to tell you what that means yet. I want you to guess what they mean as we find a solution. Going back to this equation, the first genius insight we have to use is not actually solve it for this input. Instead, what we do is solve it for a simpler signal. The simplest you could even find, the delta function. A delta function isn't even a real function. It's what we call a generalized function. That means that instead of looking at what it does to specific inputs, instead look at what it does to other functions. Specifically, when you multiply a function by the delta function, and then take the integral, you get back the original function evaluated at zero. At least, as long as the bounds contain zero, otherwise it's just zero. For this reason, we often draw the delta function as the limit of a spike when area of 1 s gets narrow. This makes have an infinite height at t equals zero, and zero everywhere else. Since that doesn't make much sense for a true function, we use the word generalized function. How do you get other points? You shift the delta function by subtracting the time you want to move by. But I don't want all these things to confuse you. The amazing property of the delta function is that it turns the whole function into a point. Taking multiple points by using the shifting property, we can get back our function at multiple points. And now here's the neat part. If we shift it by every possible value, and then take the integral from minus infinity to infinity, we get back our original function. Now all of this might sound very confusing, but it will all make sense when you get to actually solving our equation. So now, let's solve this differential equation with input, the delta function. If you think about it logically, then before t equals 0, the input was all 0, so the output must have been 0 as well. It doesn't make sense for a passive circuit to react to nothing. After t equals 0, we also do nothing, but we have done something, meaning that our input acts as a sort of initial condition. So what we have to do is solve this differential equation, which is still hard. And the only thing we can do is guess the type of function that would solve this. Polynomials won't work, because the highest order term would always stay in there. Sinusoids won't work either, because either cosine or sine would stay in there. But exponentials would work, because all of the terms would have the same form. Plugging in exponentials gives us a quadratic equation, giving us these two solutions. Now we get to what the word linear actually means. The linearity property tells us that any weighted sum of these solutions is also a solution. Adding them tells us that inputting both signals would give the output of both signals, but now added. So our last goal to solve this is to find these weights, C1 and C2. For this, we have to go back to our original equation with the delta function. Now, our trick is to use the fact that the integral of the delta function is 1. So let's take the integral on both sides from minus epsilon to epsilon and make epsilon really small. On the right hand side, you'll of course get a 2. On the left hand side, you'll get the difference in derivative of v, plus 3 times the difference in v, plus finally the integral of v from minus epsilon to epsilon. You might think that I've made the problem way harder and didn't do anything useful. But if you think about it, before t equals 0, v and its derivative was just 0, so these terms die off. And since we let epsilon get very small, this integral of v must eventually also die off. So now we get this relationship. Plugging in the v that we had, we get that c2 equals minus 2. To find c1, we have to go back again to our equation. Since integrals worked before, let's start it again. However, we can't use the same integral from minus epsilon to epsilon yet. So let's just take the integral on both sides and get a plus c. If we now take the integral from minus epsilon to epsilon, then on the left hand side, a lot of terms die off. And on the right hand side, you'll get 0, since the delta function has turned into 0 before t equals 0 and the 1 after. This epsilon integral will turn that into 0 when epsilon is small. So we get that v of epsilon is 0. Getting our constants again, we find that c1 is 2. So here we have it, 0 before t equals 0, and this after. To say that it starts at t equals 0, we multiply it by u of t, the unit step function. And as you might have noticed, it's the exact property that the integral of the delta function had as well. As it turns out, the derivative of the unit step function is the delta function, which nicely relates with this then being a full solution when the input is the delta function. Before I give you the full solution with our input x, I want to show you how to solve it for the delta function in general. If we bring out this voltage here, we can act like we're multiplying the derivative by v. This here is what we call an operator. Simply said, an operator is to a function what a number is to a function. So a function takes in a number and spits out a new number. An operator takes in a function and spits out a new function. You already know an operator. The derivative itself is an operator. It takes in t squared and gives you 2t, for example. So in general, for solving this, you see that these systems are represented by p of dy equals q of d delta, where d represents the derivative, and p and q are some linear time-invariant operators. We have yet to use the property of time invariance. So in general, we need to solve p of r equals 0 to get some exponentials, just as we did before, and then use integrals to find the weights. So now, for the input of x of t. For x of 0, we can just get the response of the delta function and then multiply the output by x of 0. We can do this because by linearity, if you scale the input, you scale the output. For later times, you have to use the fact that our system is time invariant. That means that if you apply our input at a later time, you'll still get the same response, but now later. This makes sense, because after all, why would the resistor care about when you are applying voltage? This means that we didn't just solve for the output for a delta function, but for any sum of scaled and time-shifted delta functions. And since our input, x of t, can be broken up into delta functions, that means that all we have to do is replace this delta with the v we found. This integral is called the convolution integral. It's often denoted with asterisk, and it's absolutely ubiquitous in engineering. And I want you to have a nice intuition for it. It's if we apply an initial input, then a fraction of a second later, we apply another input, then again, and so on. If you scale them properly, then by adding them all together, we get back the output of our function. As an example, if our input was u of t, so nothing before t equals 0, and constant after, we would have to calculate this. Doing the maths gives us this final response for our input. That was a lot, so let's do a quick recap of everything. The circuit will give us a linear time-invariant equation. Instead of solving this, we solved for the input as a delta function first. Obviously, before t equals 0, this is 0. Afterwards, you have to solve this equation to get exponential solutions. Then, you use the delta functions to find the initial conditions. Then by time invariance, if the response to the delta function at any time, we can get x of t back by taking this convolution integral. By linearity, the scaled and summed version of the delta function is itself a scaled and summed version of the output, which means that our output is this integral. If all of this sounds a bit convolved, that is because it actually is. If you want to find out about a genius technique to do all of these steps way faster, you should check out this next video on Laplace transform right here.